peace and blessings to you all. Is there an elder who can give me permission to speak this morning? Thank you. So I'm so glad that all of you creative people were born. I'm so glad you were born. And I want you to turn to someone and say that to them. I am so glad you were born. There you go. Even if you don't know them, we're glad that they're here. And when we were born, each and every one of us, we were born in the middle of somebody else's story. When we were born, there were narratives and situations and circumstances going on in the lives of our parents and our grandparents and our communities. And those narratives help form the first foundation of our ethics. So those complicated stories of whether someone wanted you or not, whether the relationship was healthy or the community was healthy, whatever it was, whether it was a vibrant situation, we were all born in the middle of someone else's stories, multiple complex stories. And those stories were the foundations of our first ethics. So what are ethics? Ethics are those moral principles that determine what we do and how we live. Those moral principles that dictate our behavior. Well, what are principles? So the principles are those systems of belief that we have come to adopt by way of our families, by way of what we have learned and unlearned, by way of what we have experienced on this life journey. And those moral principles that are the foundation of our ethics determine how we interact with one another. And those families that we were born into taught us those first ethics, how to act, how to speak with someone, how to reason, which is why so many of us are unreasonable. Because we were born into families whose understanding of how to reason lacked reason, and we didn't adopt new ways of reasoning, and so we have become, some of us, unreasonable people, and we know who we are. And you work with some of us, right? Ethics, principles, define who we are from the very beginning. And we spend maybe those first 10 years trying to make it work, right? Those first 10 years, we try to go along with these stories, these narratives, these principles, these ethics of these families that we are born into, except for the terrible twos. Terrible twos aren't terrible. We're just trying to define our own ethics. Don't call them terrible twos. And so for some of us, we spend the first 10 years really, really trying to embrace them and maybe the rest of our lives trying to understand them and undo them. For some of us, we are born into families and those ethics kind of work most of the time, at least those first 20 years, and then we get out on our own and, oh my gosh, my family taught me what? And we have to spend some time negotiating and understanding what it is we believe and what is going to dictate our behavior and what is going to inform how we relate to each other. For me, I was born in a family with a strong food ethic, a very strong food ethic. As a matter of fact, very often, that food ethic informed everything else and was stronger even than our religious doctrine. So I was born into a family where the cultivating of food, the understanding good soil, the love of food, of both preparing it and cooking it and growing it and serving it and sitting at a table was one of the most important things we could do. So I come from a family, a long line of family of Southern farmers and grocers and community gardeners and urban farmers. And so I don't stand here before you because there is this new local food movement. I don't stand here because everyone else has decided that food matters and the ethics of food matters. I am standing here because I was born into a family with very strong food ethics. Now, it didn't matter, they were crazy on some other things, right? And we'll come back to that. And so being born into this family with these incredible food ethics, we ate well. And we fed other people well. And I got to understand the difference between preparing food and cooking food. My father was a caterer, an incredible, incredible chef, and a baker. He didn't cook that much at home. Like most of us do in our work, what we do elsewhere, we don't tend to do at home, right? But when he did cook, it was great. And so I grew up in this family of caterers, and my mother ran grocery stores. So food was everywhere, and we fed everyone, and we set tables. We set tables. So as we grew up, and I first was born in a little still town outside of Pittsburgh called Homestead, get the irony of that, grew up to become a homesteader, but didn't understand that. And then people called us the Beverly Hillbillies, because we went from this little shack in Homestead to this sprawling suburb called Penn Hills in Pittsburgh. And so we moved to Penn Hills, and we had this beautiful brick house, and we had the big swimming pool in the backyard. We bought a pool table because we were told that every good suburbanite needed a pool table, right? Right? New car, pool table. I have no idea why, but everyone in our neighborhood had roller skates, so we had to all go out and get new roller skates to fit into Penn Hills. And then I noticed that everybody had a dog. So I said to my father, "Daddy, daddy, daddy, can we have a dog?" "No." "Daddy, can we have a dog?" "No." 2 minutes later, "I don't understand why we can't have a dog. Can we have a dog?" And so he sat down at the kitchen table and he said to me, "That dog will never be able to cook me breakfast or have food on the stove when I come home late from work." How unreasonable is that? What the hell does that have to do with anything? It wasn't until my 9th grade biology class where I understood what that had to do with anything. And so I'm sitting there in Penn Hills Intermediate School, and we're opening up our biology books and we're studying, and it dawns on me in the midst of this that we are the only living thing that cooks. We are the only living thing that prepares food for one another. We are the only living thing that uses the elements to transform what nature has created and to set a table and to invite others to the table. And so I heard my father's voice, darn it, in that 9th grade class of saying, "That dog will never be able to make me breakfast or have food on the stove for me when I come home late from work." We got the dog, by the way. We had 2 dogs. And yet, that food ethic changed my life. It was in that 9th grade classroom that I began to understand who I was created to be because of my family's food ethics. It was in that ninth grade classroom where I understood in the beginning that I need to live a life of setting tables. I need to live a life of creating tables. I need to live a life of food ethics that invites people to the table so that we can share all that is human and all that is good and all that is broken. I began to understand right there in that biology class that I aced, by the way. But I began to understand the importance of food. And so some of you have heard this story, as you all call yourself my fan club, but you have heard this story of when my father died almost 3 years ago, this incredible caterer and chef and baker who also had this incredible complexity of other things, but who cares? But when we are at his funeral, and as we're at his wake and people are sharing their condolences, oh, we're so sorry, we're so sorry. The most important question was, I'm so sorry about the loss of your father. Did anybody learn how to make his beef? Did anyone get any of his recipes? Food matters. Tables matter. And what I have learned about ethics is this. It doesn't matter if all of these other ethics are not in place in the beginning of your life. If you are born or if you acquire one good solid foundation of ethics and believe in that, and if that ethics is healthy and doesn't do anyone else harm, eventually it will impact every single thing you do. Eventually, it will impact every single person you meet. Raise your hand if I've ever fed you. The rest of you, it's coming. You will begin to impact change one thing at a time, no matter what those strong ethics are. So it doesn't matter whether yours is an ethics of food, but it does matter whether you have a strong foundation of something. Whether you have something that brings your daily life integrity and worth. Whether you have something that you can stand on that makes you feel good about every breath you take. It is my thing, though, because I'm a little biased, that the ethics of food is one of the most important ethics. Why? Because everybody has to eat. Everybody has to eat. And preparing a meal and sharing a meal with someone is one of the most intimate things you can do. I even say that it's even more intimate than the act of sharing good sex. Don't get nervous. I even say that good food can be better than good sex for just several reasons. Number one, the lights are normally on. And your eyes are normally open. Normally. And you can see the other person most of the time during a meal. You can't say that about sex. You're not always in a position to look in someone's eyes. But you know what? I'm not going to go into your bedrooms right now. Good food might lead to good sex. How about that? How about that? And so today I have an invitation for you. It is an invitation that I have extended multiple times before to people, and they have gotten scared, afraid. She is crazy. And so just a year ago, and 5 years ago, and 6 years ago, I started inviting people to invite others to a meal. Invite other people who you do not know to a meal. And so what you are getting are some questions. And what your assignment is, because if you thought you were coming and you weren't going to have any homework, sorry. Your assignment, even right here, right now in this room, is before you leave, make an appointment with a stranger to have a meal? How creative are you really willing to be? Because vulnerability and creativity go together. So this morning, it is Creative Mornings Milwaukee, but it's Vulnerability Mornings Milwaukee. I strongly believe that a strong food ethic and sitting at a table with someone and sharing your story is the most important thing you can do on a daily basis. What if once a week you had a meal with a stranger, which could translate into somebody strange, but that's another speech, right? And so the questions that you have are questions that I use in my rites of passage work. When I'm working with women and girls and other species, men, and we are in the midst of things, these are some of the questions that they are assigned to ask themselves. I am inviting you to ask one another, who or what were you named after? You could have a whole meal over your name. When you look in the mirror, what do you see? Who do you see? What is a symbol that represents your life? What is the greatest gift you have received from your ancestors? Do you even think about your ancestors? Do you think about them? And what story will future generations tell about you and about us and about our ethics? I stand here this morning, and almost every morning, heartbroken over what I awakened to. And so today, I remember that on this day in 2012, Trayvon Martin was killed by a stranger. What would have happened had he invited him to a meal? What would have happened if he had sat at table with this boy's humanity? What have happened? I stand here brokenhearted from people who think it's okay to just take another person's life. This is an invitation to develop an ethics that always starts at a table. Whether it's that incredible table back there that I'm trying to convince them that I should take home with me. Whether it is your tables at work, Creative Milwaukee, please come back to the table. And so, my work with you here today is done, and yours has just begun, right? So you need to invite someone, and I want to know who you're taking out for a meal. Those of you who know me, I'm aggressive, I'm not shy, I might have you sign up, right? But the beautiful thing is, we are starting a movement here today, a continuum in time that is so important. So I'm only asking you to share a meal and share your story. Share your meal. Share your story. The next time you see him, I'm going to ask you to cook, but we're just going to keep it small. Please, the table and food is sacred. The table and cooking and fire is holy. You are holy. I invite you this morning into my ethics of food. Thank you. Oh. Thank you.